good evening, all of you. From here, Kulu Valley, this is Sonali from the Himalayan Institute of Cultural and Heritage Studies, and I welcome you all for the fifth lecture in our lockdown series. And as our government has suggested, now we're going to be unlocked phase by phase. So I think I'll have to rename our series into something else, but the lock has to be there. So here today, we present Dr. Anjali Kapila for the second time. She gave a wonderful lecture some weeks ago on the women of the Garhwal Himalayas. And today she'll be talking about the Ganga River, so holy, from Gangotri to Haridwar. And Dr. Anjali Kapila's enthusiasm and the support to all of us is incredible. And I'm so, so honored that you are on this forum and engaging and making us meet each other so that work on the Himalayas is noticed and we keep working at it. So thank you once again, and the platform is yours now.
So I'm going to take you all on this wonderful journey for 1 minute and 13 seconds. Please see this video.
Vijay, we can't see the video.
Can't see the video. ऑडियो नहीं आ रहा मुझे ऑडियो नो ऑडियो इज नॉट कमिंग ऑडियो
Can you hear it now?
No. No audio.
Oh, we can't
no audio?
No.
No.
I can hear it perfectly.
No.
I can hear it perfectly. Sonali, can I give you the remote control?
Remember to share computer sound when sharing the screen. Vijay, did you
yeah,
share
maybe. The... I think I did, but let me check.
Computer sound.
Yeah. Where is the thing of sharing computer sound?
When you click the share screen button, it comes in that. A dialogue comes up inside the share screen button.
Share. Yeah, it's all there.
Is it share computer sound on?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I'm sharing computer sound. It's taking a bit of time, but let me see.
Okay, let's try. Otherwise, I'll start the
video. Yeah. गंगा भागीरथी जगी जली धूप पहली बार देखी तेरू बिकराली रूप ग गंगा भागीरथी तेरु विकराल रूप नारिंगो की धानी नारिंगो की धानी गंगा भागीरथी नारिंगो की धानी गोमुखने छोटी शिव जट समानी गंगा भागीरथी शिव जट समानी गुलोलू की गारे गुलोलू की गारे जगी जा
ओके So I want to say to all of you, it's wonderful to be here with all of you and share with you my wonderful journey of documenting a riverine culture, the people's Ganga from Gangotri to Haridwar. This is a project under the aegis of the Janpat Sampada Division of the Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, commissioned by the head who's listening to this talk, Molly Kaushal, and my two advisors to this project are Sukrita Paul Kumar and Professor S.C. Malik. Now, why do I call it the People's Ganga? As you all know, you're very familiar with the Ganga. The Ganga traverses 2,005 kilometers of India's hinterland. And as it moves from focal points from the Himalayas, from Gomukh, where it originates, to Ganga Sagar, it travels this long distance. But I am focusing on the Himalayan Ganga, which is 350 kilometers from Gangotri to Haridwar. And I call it the People's Ganga because innumerable textual or traditions and books have been written about the mythology and the origin of the Ganga, but not so much information is available about how people relate to the Ganga. What is this intersecting relationship? How do people view the Ganga? What is the Ganga for them in their lives? Do they sing about her? Are there stories about her? And how do they relate to the Ganga, worship it, venerate it, celebrate it, or feel sad in their daily lives? So this is a journey where you're going to listen to the voices of the people. I may not sing as much as I did the last time, but wherever I do get an opportunity, but do listen to people's voices from the ground. This is a moment of sharing with you my journey. Next. So this is the core team, Swati Kukreti, Manoj Pandey of Himalaya Seva Sangh. Aranya Ranjan is the president of Uttarakhand Jan Jagriti Sansthan, and Garima Mehndi Ratta was the research assistant. Now, this was the field team. Besides the field team, I do want to bring here at this moment, and I know at least one of the wonderful members who have contributed very richly to this book is here, which is Bhavna Pankaj. Bhavna transcribed and transcreated all the songs from Hindi to English, which are presented in the book and which you will get an opportunity to read. And Mahipal Singh Negi, a very eminent scholar from New Tiri, transcribed the songs from Garhwali to Hindi. So what you're going to see in the book and what you're going to see today is the English version, but you will be hearing the original Garhwali version as we go along. Next. So this whole journey is an ethnographic research study which looks at the intersecting relationship of people and the river Ganga in the Garhwal region. So this is the upper Himalayan Ganga, and we look at mythology, songs and rituals of people. Through this research, we are able to discover different aspects of the life of the people in the Ganga River Valley. And I want to reiterate here that there is a conceptual framework which is looking at the interlinkages between culture, ecology of the river, and development. So the cultural landscape, the sacred cultural landscape of the river Ganga, the ecology of the river, these two cannot be, culture and ecology cannot be divorced from each other, and neither can development. But as we go along, you will see the impact that development, globalization and liberalization has had on the river, and how people are singing about these dynamic changes that are happening to the river every day in their lives. Next. Okay, so here is the locales covered. This is my interpretation and my sketch of Lord Shiva and the forest and his matted locks and the Himalayan peaks from where the Ganga is emerging. Now, if you see this journey on the left-hand side, I have Gomukh, a temple in Gangotri, Mukwa, which is the natal home of Ganga Devi, where she goes in the winter months, Harsil, Raithal, Uttarkashi, Dunda, the Tiri Dam, Thadi, Koteshwar Dam, Dev Prayag, where the Alaknanda River and the Bhagirathi meet, and from where it is believed that the Ganga actually starts from here. And then we go on to Rishikesh and Haridwar. So this is very broadly in a sketch, the locales that will be covered. Next. Now Khadi is where we began our journey. Tipli is a village near Khadi. Mukwa is the natal home of Ganga. Harsil is 3 kilometers from Ganga. It is a cantonment town with beautiful Devdar forest and meadow. And I will be speaking and taking you to each part of this geographical locale. But this is just to give you an idea that in this journey, look at the gamut of areas that we covered in order to hear people's voices and the voices of the river. So finally, we end up in Haridwar, which is the Harika Dwar. We are at Gangotri town. Pilgrims are here at the feet of the Gangotri. The temple is worshipped by the feet of the Gangotri river. We have the Shivling Hagirathi feet from where Gomukh is located, and the Ganga flows down from here. Then you come down to Harsil, which is 30 kilometers below Gangotri. The Ganga at Harsil is absolutely beautiful, pristine, and clear. And Harsil is a small cantonment town. It is 3 kilometers from Mukwa, which is located across the river. This is a small Shiva temple, which is there located at the Sangam of the Jalandhari River and the Bhagirathi River, which the Jalandhari River flows into the Bhagirathi River. So in the context of studying the river, it is very important to study the tributaries also. Vijay Jhardari ji, who lives in Nagni village, he reiterated to me several times that Anjali, you have to study the tributaries in order to study the main Ganga. Now, in Harsil, I met a wonderful woman called Basanti Negi. I'm going to take a little time. She is absolutely iconic. So these are the faces of the people from the valley whom I'm introducing you. Basanti Negi is the Gram Panchayat of village Harsil. She believes in working collectively. She has created a small Mahila Sangh, and together with her women, she has saved the beautiful Devdar forest, which was being felled by woodcutters who had come there. Now look at her management strategies. These are unlettered women who have never been to school, but their life and their wisdom traditions, she says, comes from the river. Now, how does she learn? What does she learn from the river? She says, just like the river flows eternally and continuously, my wisdom and my interaction with the river, with the forest, with my land has to flow continuously. And when I also want to add at this point that I had taken several students with me on this journey. 4 students were on a study abroad program from the Michigan State University and 4 students from Lady Irwin College. So this was their research study program, and it was a great learning for them. And when Basanti Negi was speaking, one of the students said that we could have never got better orientation to gender than we could have by listening to Basanti Negi. We now come to the temple town of Mukwa. From Mukwa, we move to the temple town of Raithal. This is Rana Kameru's house at Raithal. It is a 5-storied house, 500 years old. The Bhagwati temple is located in a courtyard in Raithal. Now, the culture of this region is very important to understand. Here you can see the women of the village Raithal performing the Tandi dance, and Jalam Dasji is playing the dhol. He is from the Dholi Parivar. Now we are coming down to Uttarkashi. This is, we are located at an organization called Himalaya Paryavaran Shikshan Sansthan, run by Suresh Bhai, who is started and he's an activist. He's a social activist, and he started an organization called Nadi Bachao Andolan. So what was wonderful of being here, I and the research team lived here for several days, that women from neighboring villages were invited every day to be with us the whole day. and they would regale us with songs about the river. In fact, I'm going to sing to you one of the songs. Gaumukh Nandi Jandi Haridwar, Ganga Bhagirathi Jandi Haridwar. Gaumukh Nandi Jandi Haridwar, Ganga Bhagirathi Jandi Haridwar. Naringo Kidani, Ganga Bhagirathi Shiva Jata Samani, Ganga Bhagirathi Shiva Jata Samani. Next. Next. Okay, so now near this ashram, I meet this wonderful Swami called Swami Sachidanand. All of us walk down to the river to hear the sound of the river, and we meet him. Swami Sachidanand has been living in a mud hut. He is a professor from Karnataka University. And he says he became a professor at a very young age. At 35, he was a professor. But when he came to this place, to Uttarkashi Ashram, and he heard the sound of the river, he said ki ganga ki dhwani sunkar, ganga ka omkar aur om sunkar, mere paon yahi pe gad gaye. Means I got so rooted in this in this earth that I haven't moved from here for the last 30 years. Sachidananji's words, Bharati Sanskriti Ganga par hi tiki hui hai. Such wonderful that our whole culture is dependent on the river. Our lives are linked to the river Ganga. And he said that the river Ganga flows at three levels. It flows in Swarg, which is heaven. It flows in Patal, which is underground. And it flows on the earth. And he said that it is our duty to preserve the eternal Ganga ko aviral aur nirmal behne do. Aviral means let the river flow eternally and let it be pure and clean. Our lives are deeply linked to the river. Our conversation with Sachidanand was so rich. And I don't know if I can introduce you to all the people. Maybe some other time, if any one of you are interested, would love to take you on this journey to share our experiences and the wonderful people that we... Next. Then we come down to Khadi. I've already spoken to you about Aranya Ranjan, who is the president of Uttarakhand Jan Jagriti Sansthan. Khadi is located on one of the tributaries of the Ganga River, which is the Hewal River. And Aranya's parents, Pratap Bhai and Dulari Bhen, were part of the Chipko movement. They were Sarvodaya leaders. What is interesting is that families that have come up, and there are lots of couples who work together as partners. Now, this kind of partnership I've seen very rarely in urban cities where two people are totally committed to the same issue. But I met such wonderful Dhoom Singh Negi and his wife Renu, Sundarlal Bahuguna and his wife Vimla Di, Pratap Bhai and his wife Dulari. So they had set up this organization which became a home to the entire team. So we've had several meetings here where scholars who have worked on the Ganga, people who feel for the river, people who understand their river, this became a venue for interacting with people and learning and growing with them. Next. Here you can see the process, how we work. Every morning, the whole entire research team, the students from Michigan State University and from Lady Irwin, Aranya and I, and whoever was present there, we would sit together, we would understand how are we going to spend the whole day. See, nobody has, you have a map in your head, but you don't know how it is going to transact as you move around. If somebody just says document the culture of the Ganga for 350 kilometers, you may know your geographical location and your journey, but you do not actually know how it is going to turn out in reality on a day-to-day basis. So this moment was very important. Every day in the morning we would meet, we would understand from each other and listen to each other. And what is interesting is Aranya's daughters are also listening to this conversation, almost as if the future generation is being involved in our relationship with the river. Next. So from Khadi, we move on to the beautiful town of Devprayag. I think many of you have visited this absolutely iconic confluence of the Bhagirathi River and the Alaknanda. The Bhagirathi is the river that we are walking along, traveling along, and the Alaknanda is coming from Kedarnath and Badrinath. So the two rivers merge here. You can see the difference in the color. The Bhagirathi is blue in color and the Alaknanda is a little gray in color. There is a lovely story here that in 2013, when the floods came and the Ganga was rising up, I believe all these houses were submerged, and the Ganga was rising because she wanted to touch the feet of Lord Raghunath. This temple in Devprayag is very famous. So the priest of this temple shared this story with me, that we took the idol of Ram out of the temple and took it to touch the feet of Ganga, and the Ganga River receded. Now, I mean, you may believe or not believe the story, but this is a wonderful myth that is prevalent. And what is interesting is that these myths permeate the lives of the people, and they also show you the deep interrelationship that they have with the river. I want you to listen to a little bit of the sound of the river as it is covered by the river. It's almost as if the Bhagirathi and the Alaknanda are coming together. And then I just think of the Georgia and the Ganga. It's such a beautiful metaphorical image where the two rivers are merging together and come together without retaining their identity to create the Ganga.
It's not a color.
One is gray and one is blue. So Devprayag is a very important Sangam. A lot of people come here to bathe. This is a shot we took of the Ganga Dasehra, which is celebrated a month after Akshay Tithi, which is the day the Kapats in Gangotri open. From Rishikesh, we move to Haridwar, Harika Dwar. Now we move on to the methodology. I've taken you to the entire journey. Now, who did we interview? Who did we speak to? We spoke to village women, we spoke to village men, we spoke to young adults, 18 to 25 years of age, we spoke to NGO activists, organizations that have been living along the river. We spoke to priests of the Gangotri temple, of the Makpa temple. We spoke to sadhus and saints. We spoke to many journalists who have written about the river. We spoke to theater groups, to school children, and to well-known folk singers and musicians. Now, why so many people in order to ascertain the voices? Because this would represent the diversity of the people's voices of the river. And that is why, like, it's like throwing a wide net. And how did we listen to the voices of the Ganga? As I shared with you, we held several meetings, we listened to stories, we heard narratives from people, we observed how people interact with the river, we had group discussions with scholars, we heard songs, and we held several interviews. The book is going to be an audiovisual book, so those of you who are going to have the book will hear not only the songs that are embedded in the text of the book, which is 50 songs, but we'll also get to hear the interviews of all the people who we spoke to. Now let's listen to, I call it the voices of the river, the people's perspective. How did we structure the entire research? When we collected the 50 songs, what did we do? Like I shared with you in the last presentation, that it was the women of the villages that did the classification. in this case also, I will share with you as we move around the five conceptual themes and frameworks that emerged from looking at the 50 songs and poems that we collected. So the voices of the river have been represented in five conceptual chapters and frameworks. These are very different from the way that songs of the Ganga have been classified by earlier scholars. So one theme looks at the mythology, journey and worship of the river. One theme looks at the festivals along the river. Another theme looks at women and water. And another theme is the ecological perspectives. And the last theme is modernity and change. Now, you will wonder, how did I arrive at all these five thematic areas? When we would, when after we had collected the songs, we would read out, before they were transcribed into English also, we would read out the Hindi version aloud in a group to women sitting with us. And we would see that some songs describe the mythology of the river. Some songs describe the journey of the river. Some songs talked about worship. How should I worship you? The flowers and incense. How do I tell you that I adore you, dear Ganga? Then there were many songs about the festivals of the river. There are several festivals held along the river. The most important one is the Makar Sankranti festival, which is held at Uttarkashi, where villagers bring their local devtas to bathe in the river on the Makar Sankranti night. Then there was another very important section which looks at women's integral relationship to water. And within this thematic section also, several subsections emerged. Women's relationship with the river, women and life cycle events, intergenerational views of the river, like views of the grandmother, views of the mother, views of the young daughter and her relationship to the river. Then women talked a lot about the psychological, emotional and social connect with the river. So these were sub-themes, and there are songs representing each theme. That is what is interesting, and these have emerged from, now isn't this interesting that from field work, you get the song, and from the song emerges the theme. And the classification or whatever scholars do, what I want to say is, I really give the value to the people themselves who have created these representations. We are only talking about them in a language that, you know, may not be their own language. But I feel very happy that these are reaching out to people and to a wider audience. Now, whenever we spoke about the river, women reiterated to me, Ganga, O great goddess Ganga, to your palace in the heavens where you lived without care, did Bhagirath offer sacrifice, make you aware of the deathly world of mortals, fires of contrition, his pleading, his mission melted you. Mounting the Makara, you came with waters of life in pitcherly frame. You, of such otherworldly beauty, resplendent in your molten attire, you set the Himalayas afire. A goddess descended as mother. This song has been translated from the original Garhwali into Hindi by Mahipal Negi and into English beautifully by Bhavna. I think she's sitting in this gathering. She may want to say something. This poetic form is so beautiful. Next. So I'm showing you representing of one song from each section. Thank you. of Mustik Sword. Mustik Sword is the place where this the Devta is going. Hands folded to you, we bow. Hari Maharaj of Baragadi, famed deity, then and now. Milk, curds, and butter we bring, tokens of our adoration. For your worship and for your bath, Lord. Blessed colors for our jubilation. Ruler of our spirit, Maharaj, of Uttarkashi, reigning deity, fragrance and lamps, dear Lord. In flow, in spontaneity, Vaishakh, Bhadon, festive months, and you, the center of our celebration, blessing our daughters ever, Maharaj, hold us in your veneration.
Oh, मेरो मैत पानी मा समानु च गौ मुलक पानी मा समानु च गौ मुलक पानी मा समानु च धारा मंगरा पानी काई डूबे जाला जोड़िया सौ जोड़िया दगड़िया बिछुड़ी जाला दादी की कथों की गवेवा चुल खांदी चोर सिपे खेल थो जख चुल भांडी राज लुका छिपी पीठा पंच गारा राज लुका छिपी पीठा पंच गारा मेरो बचपन पानी मा समानुच मेरो बचपन पानी मा समानुच
तीरी द लैंड ऑफ माय बर्थ इज डाइंग माय होम दैट वंस वाज इज डाइंग स्वर्लिंग वाटर्स स्वॉलो अप हट एंड हैमलेट फ्रेंड्स ऑफ इन्फेंसी रिसीड Tombstone stories told by the old mother alone will live. Games of childhood have gone into eternal hiding. How shall we seek them now? Alas, the thief has won. Courtyards dappled by love of mothers, sanctuary of fathers, have been swamped away, compounds of marriage. I mean, can you feel their loss? This song is so beautiful. It is totally describing women's sadness of losing. 125 villages have been submerged in the Tiri Dam just to provide electricity to urban centers like Delhi. It is so sad. Next.
Hai jagi jawa biji jawa uthe jawa he jagi jawa biji jawa uthe jawa he जागी जावा बिजी जावा उठी जावा हे जागी जावा बिजी जावा उठी जावा हे आज सुने सान वे गिदारा पन्यारा आज सुने सान वे गिदारा पन्यारा बांजा पड़ी गे आज गोर गुठियारा बांजा पड़ी गे आज गोर गुठियारा तुम ते बटाणी आज माटी अखरे तुम ते बटाणी आज माटी अखरे जागी जावा बिजी जावा उठी जावा हे जागी जावा बिजी जावा उठी जावा हे जो डांडो बस द छया गुगते हिलास जो डांडो बस द छया गुगते हिलास
Rise, slumbering one, rise, wake up, heed your own cries. Watch with your eyes the desert of your dreams. Your ears to the ground hear your screams. Your wells are tearless, your pots futile, your mountains birdless, your life fragile. The cattle are gone, the fires fading, hopes perishing, death awaiting. Ghost homes, grasslands bald, the tree lines waning, cool wafts now scald. Wake up, slumbering one, to the loss at hand. Rise, O man, to the call of the land. Now look at the way, the women and the people of the village are linking ecological perspectives to the river. You can't just leave your villages. You can't just cut all your forests. You can't just build all weather roads. You can't cut the beautiful 200 feet tall Devdar trees so that Mercedes cars and BMWs and four lane highways can go to Gangotri and to the temple towns. Is this the name of development? At every moment, at every press conference, I said, aap Sanskriti aur Vikas ka vibhajan nahi kar sakte. These two are deeply linked. And this is something for each one of us to think about very deeply, that culture, ecology, and development cannot be divorced from each other. So what at the cost of development, what? The river is going. You may say beautiful Ganga, venerate her, worship her, take her as a taker away of your sins. But what are we doing to the river? I mean, these are moments and these songs are created by the village people themselves. Next.
पर्वत की चिट्ठी ले जाना तू सागर की ओर नदी तू बहती रहना नदी तू बहती रहना नदी तू बहती रहना नदी तू बहती रहना एक दिन मेरे गांव में आना बहुत उदासी है सबकी प्यास बुझाने वाली तू खुद प्यासी है तेरी प्यास बुझाए हम में है वो जोर नदी तू बहती रहना नदी तू बहती रहना नदी तू बहती रहना नदी तू बहती रहना तू ही मंदिर तू ही मस्जिद तू ही पंच प्रयाग तू ही सीढ़ीदार खेत है तू ही रोटी तुझे बेचने आए हैं ये पूंजी के चोर नदी तू बहती रहना 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 नदी तू
Rise and roll, beloved river, missive of the mountain, take to the ocean shore. Rise and roll, beloved, surge and soar. Stop by for a cup of woe in my village of sadness. Giver of joy, could you loan us, perhaps, some of your gladness? But quencher of thirst, I see thine own throat is dry, your earth desiccated, arid your sky. Our priestess of plenty, you are our temple, you the holy place. You, the heart of a pilgrim, you, the sacred space, terrace fields and harvest you, you, the fire and bread, you, our lamp and light and flower. Now look at this beautiful song written by a poet called Atul Sharma and sung by the people in the NGO where we lived at Himalaya Paryavaran Shikshan Sansthan. These activists are making these songs and spreading the content of these songs and the messages all along the river. But who can quench the thirst? Because you have dammed the river. 42 square kilometers of this huge big lake, 125 villages submerged. People have lost their homes. They have been displaced. Can we quench the thirst of these people who have moved away to urban lands, who have migrated, leaving their beautiful homes? Next. Now, you know, to look at the Tiri Dam looks beautiful. I mean, it looks so aesthetic. You can go here for a holiday. And those of you who are interested, these little huts in the dam are a hotel. You can take a boat from the side and go and stay here and enjoy. But always remember at what cost all this has happened to the people who belong to this land. And so when we are talking about the river, you know, this is important. We just cannot ignore these aspects. Now you're going to ask me a question. Okay, Anjali, you documented the song of the river. So what? What is the way forward? How do we move forward? And so the way forward we thought was to interact with the young people of this region in colleges, in schools, and to orient them. When we did the intergenerational views, one of the young people I interviewed, you know, she said, oh, I don't have any relationship with Ganga water. I can outsource it online. She studies agriculture in Dehradun. And whereas her mother said to me, that when I get up every morning and I see the Ganga, my day is made, my life is made. I can spend and do all my hard work just by having a sight of the Ganga. And her grandmother walked across the Ganga with her chappals off, barefoot, because she said ki maa ke upar koi chappal pehen ke chal sakta hai. So I felt that it was very necessary, and our whole team felt that we should take this work forward. And we did this by visiting several schools. This is only one image that I'm showing you, where Manoj Bhai is talking, and the young people were so interested because they don't know these songs. We have to share these songs with them. We have to share these stories. We have to share the stories of change. They see the change, but they are not connecting it to what is happening. So this is a theater workshop that we had on the river Ganga at Khadi. All these young people in their summer months, they come here and they are writing a script on the river, on the journey of the river and how the river is changing. And these are all people who are sharing their songs and their views with them. So they are enacting a theater, a street theater, which they have performed at different places in the village, in Khadi, at Nagni, at Devprayag. So this whole team moves around and performs this little theater group that they have formed about the Ganga. So I also want to add that in the last time, Molly had mentioned that Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts is going to print the songs and distribute it to the people. So I want to end with this beautiful saying by Dhoom Singh Negi, chal pade to chal pade, ye kaam fursat ka nahi hai, ye ek lagan hai, ye ek jeevan hai. You know, don't look at things like a project. Oh, you know, I have a project to document the river. This is much more than a project. This is a lifetime. This is a passion. Thank you so much.
Very well spoken.
Very well spoken.
It was really very interesting.
Thank you, everybody.
At this point, I'll ask everybody to mute their audios and can have their videos. They can start their videos. And if you could raise your hands, we can take the questions one by one. But before that, I do want to say that the book that Dr. Anjali is holding, A River Sings.
I want to show this to everybody. I want to show this. Shanali, can we do that?
Yeah. So if you could take a little, a little away from the screen, we'll be able to see it clearly.
Is that better?
A little up, yeah. So this is the book, A River Sings, and we are so happy that this is the first lecture that she's given based on this book, which is to be released in a book launch. And speak about the book launch, and those of you who want to work on ancient rivers have to come to Kullu Valley, where the book will be launched, and we'll be doing a workshop on ancient rivers. And all those who are interested in joining this, start writing into us. So that was the announcement. And I do want to tell Dr. Anjali about the amazing lecture that she gave, documenting intangible heritage with passion, with so much of hope and soulfulness, which is so, so needed.
Shanali, before we take questions, can we ask Molly Kaushal to say something, because this is her project?
Huh? Of course, please do that.
Molly? Is Molly there? Is Molly Kaushal there? Can you see?
Yeah, it's not my project, Anjali, and it's your project. Can you hear me? And I think it's wonderful work that you've done. The songs really touches so deep. The project that Anjali did was under the Riverine Cultures program of the Janpat Sampada Division. And I'm so glad that it's happened and we have now beautiful songs and beautiful photography and videos. And my only concern is when I look at all this and then look at other projects in the Janpat Sampada Division that are being done on rivers and their intangible cultural heritage, I wonder when the tangible is already at the verge of extinction, how long the intangible would survive. And also what moves me towards, you know, understanding the whole process in which we can get back the paradise lost, if it's not lost forever, is that what ecological wisdom, what economic wisdom can we bring into our policy discourses? You know, one of my other colleagues, Abhay Mishra, has also worked on Ganga and he's written two beautiful books. And one of it is like a novel, and I want to quote the way his book ends, that ultimately your policy is that all the rivers should be combined together so the water problems are resolved. So in the end, you are left with Ganga. All rivers are Ganga, but there is no Gangajal. So I think that sums up also Anjali's research. And I'm so glad that we're going to take these songs to children, because tomorrow's policymakers are these children. And if the intangible stays with them in some tangible form, then perhaps our rivers would flow again. We'll rethink our policies of dams. Tiri, when she talked about it in the song, it touched me so much that our homelessness of some has become the economic wisdom of today, or an aesthetic experiencing of those who actually know nothing about our rivers. Thank you very much for your beautiful talk. I really loved it, yeah. And it makes me think more and more about our rivers.
Thank you, Molly. Thank you so much. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you for giving us the privilege to have you and do this project with you. Thank you so much.
And you know, as Dr. Kaushal was mentioning about the river, the homelessness of people, I think world over, that's the story, because even in Egypt, when the Aswan High Dam was built, it really shifted, like displaced a lot of people, the inhabitants, the Nubians, and it just, all the history was gone, and UNESCO's efforts were needed to put that tangible heritage to higher elevation. And the stories, one of my colleagues back at UCLA is also documenting those stories and making a film on it. So this really resonates with, you know, our roots, identity, and things like that. And I'm so happy that first was an opportunity to learn from Dr. Kapila about the importance of Ganga, not just in our history, but the people who are associated with the Ganga. It's so important to know their stories as well.
Any questions?
I don't have any hands raised, so if you have questions, please raise your hands on tab.
Can I come in, please? Can I say something? Sukrita here.
That's some of the black olives you want.
Sukrita, bolo.
Okay. So what I wanted to say was that, of course, congratulations, Anjali. I know how we were sitting and, you know, conceptualizing conceptualizing when you were really very, very passionate about the whole project theoretically at one point. And then, of course, all this happened in terms of mapping of the area and the points that you have raised, I think, through, fortunately, not so much of talking, but more of songs which speak for themselves. Because obviously, there's been a particular kind of a selection of the songs also, which is very pertinent here as to how do you select the songs. Because there could have been a whole lot of just mythological or songs or maybe just, you know, veneration or worshipping of a certain kind, which of course everybody thinks of sacredness associated with Ganga. But I think you have selected the songs which are actually very contemporary as well. And what I want to really, again, it's not really a question, but it's just, I'm adding to the pathos, which is in a way, I think very, again, very relevant here, because I think the stressing of the pathos that one is talking about has something to do with what kind of even aesthetics are getting to be evolved out there. The aesthetics are that of going on into wondering what is happening, what was and what is now. So I think this in itself is a period, it's a transition of a certain kind, which is not, which is actually recording the degeneration, but the awareness of the degeneration that comes through the songs. And therefore, what I really want to focus on is your intergenerational interaction that you really worked out, which I think is very, very important, because it's the next generation and the young people who need to awaken to what we of our generation were blinded to at some point. We were totally blinded to this. I think this opening up of the eyes that can happen through aesthetics, because what is after all a song? It touches you, and it touches you, and in that it awakens you. So I think this kind of a documentation is very, very important. And my question really goes to, again, what Molly was saying, how does this really translate into action program? I think, again, the action program policy making can happen as and when it does. But I'm in a way answering my own question. But even the arousal of the young people's hearts at this point of time is pertinent. I would suggest to IGNCA to make little program, little kind of awareness programs around these songs, and also make booklets out of this, which could get into the curriculum of children's education. You know, and that is what I hope you're trying to connect up with the educationists, and also building up a certain kind of a base for introducing little, little kind of thematic concerns which are related to Ganga and which can be into the curriculum somehow. Thank you so much.
Sonali, has anybody else raised their hand?
Yes, many. So I'll take the first question by Sashi Balasubramaniam, and then after her, whoever is in order. So you can take the mic, Sashi ji.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. No, I don't have a question as such, just a point for all of us to reflect. It's very true that those in the vicinity of the rivers feel that their whole lifestyles and their cultural values are being degenerated. But I think we all have to admit that we in the city and the urban areas have contributed largely to it with our insatiable thirst. With our insatiable thirst for development in the modern sense. But to a large extent, even the rural areas, even in the hilly regions around the rivers, they thirst for development too. They are watching TV, they are watching the internet. They know what life like is elsewhere. So I think, for example, instead of making a dam there so that we can spoil that territory and we can get the electricity at reasonable rates, maybe we should concentrate on giving them solar power better, giving them gas facilities more easily, so they're not obliged to cut down the trees. It has to be made almost free for them, so that they are not tempted to assist us in degenerating their ecology.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your comment. I think all your comments are very valid. Very, very valid. All your suggestions, Rashi, thank you for listening. Thank you so much for listening.
I loved the pick of your songs. Each Thank of those you. Songs was extremely expressive, very touching, and very true to the heart, really.
I have 50 songs. These are only five. Yes. You have to read the book.
We wait for it to come out. But you are having the workshop release in Kullu, Manali. I am here at Pondicherry.
No. The release will be in Delhi.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Maybe I'll come to Pondicherry.
Come along. You're welcome. This is a small, quaint town. You'll enjoy it.
So, thank you, Sashiji. We'll take Sukanya Maloli with her question next.
Yeah. Good evening. I'm Dr. Sukanya, head of the Department of Journalism, St. Philomena's College, Mysore. So I just heard and the program was very good. Only thing is, I saw that there was an interaction with the college students there. So we didn't get any feedback from the students. What happened? What did the students respond?
Yeah, Sukanya, that's a good question, you know, because in this presentation, I can't speak about everything. But, you know, the students were so enthused. Actually, they had a leader. So, you know, I found that the leader himself was working in Dev Prayag in keeping the river clean. So he was going to involve all the young people in the college on cleaning the river, on removing the garbage and the waste, on urging people not to throw waste into the river. And also a movement for, you know, stopping the commercial vehicles. So what is happening is that a lot of activism is kind of coming up, and the young people, you have to use some kind of vehicle to go to the pilgrim sites and to the temple towns. But you don't have to then also demand that there should be shops selling butter chicken and liquor shops on the way, because all this all this garbage is thrown in. All the waste from hotels and ashrams is thrown into the river. What are we doing in the name of development? I mean, this is a huge, big crisis on our hands. So should pilgrimage, should the nature of pilgrimages change? Should there be a law against pilgrimages on pilgrim routes? We have to allow people some facilities, but with maybe some guidelines. So I think the young people were really very, very attentive, because you are our lifeline. And it is, while they didn't relate to it directly, because their lives are not touched by the river like their mother's lives were. They didn't have to go either and wash their clothes there or bathe there or worship it in that, because they don't see the connection. But I think after we spoke to them, they realized the interconnectedness of the river to ecology. So these kind of interconnections also have to be brought in. The river is not just a body of liquid water, as Diana calls it, flowing from one point to another. It is much more than that. It is a whole life. It's the whole, so it's very important that we have these dialogues with the thing. I think you asked a very good question. Thank you, Sukanya. I'll think about this more. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. One more thing, in continuation of this, don't we think that we all know everything, that we have to protect rivers, we have to protect the natural resources, but do you think we are helpless?
No, I think, you know, I don't know if we are helpless. I think we need to do a deep rethinking. And this present pandemic is linked to that deep rethinking. What have we done to our universe, to our biodiversity, to our cultural landscape, to our ecology? What have we done? So I think this pandemic is leading us. Perhaps we will change, Sukanya.
Those of us who talk to the better. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. We next have Dr. Kaushal with her question.
Yeah, I was just wondering, Anjali, how did women, did women tell you, or because you said that the categories and the conceptualization is coming in terms of how women looked at these songs. So I was interested in knowing what your questions were. And then how did they tell you, why did they sing the songs that they sang to you? Did they also explain why they were asking you to record these particular songs? I mean, you've already had 50 songs. I'm sure there are hundreds more. But obviously these women and these men thought that these are the songs that they need to tell you about. So that's what I was interested in.
Actually, Molly, I should put it in the correct way. You know, the women did not say that these are the songs that So if we had, say, a meeting in the temple town of Mukwa, now Mukwa is her natal home. So people from Mukwa say ki Ganga to hamari hai, wo to yahan se jaati hai Gangotri. She only goes there for a little while. This is her home. This is her mother's home. So they relate to it at a very emotional level. So the songs that they sang were, you know, Ganga meri pyari ma, Bhagwati tu deni vejaya, kadi rendi tu Shivji ka mund ma, kadi rendi tu barfili thand ma, Ganga ma, cham 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 kandi meri Ganga ma. So they sang all the songs about their relationship with the river. They did not sing these dam songs and all that. So I'm saying that when I asked them that Ganga ke geet, Ganga ma ko pyar tum karte ho, so they sang songs. It was later when we looked at the content of these songs that, you know, they came under worship and mythology. So it was later that, you know, we said that ye geet kiske baare mein. So they said ki ye Raja Bhagirath ne tapasya kari sagar ke 60,000 putron ko sadgati dilwane ke liye. So then they reiterated that the songs that they were singing were about mythology. But we did not tell them that they are using these songs. Whatever songs people sang, which were, you know, akin to their being and to their thought processes, we recorded them as is, where is. But when we looked at the songs themselves and did the narrative analysis and the content, the songs were falling into these various categories. So it was a very natural process. There was no saying ki ab aap Tiri Dam ke gaane ga do, ab aap development ke gaane ga do, ab aap journey ke gaane ga do, ab aap worship ke gaane ga do, ab aap migration ke ga do, not there. So it was only later on when we heard the songs and we all sat together that, you know, the dominant discourse coming out of each song. So we put them into those categories emerging. But the women sang naturally. They didn't sing like that.
There was also this modern poem in Hindi, a man was singing. Would you tell a little more about that?
Yeah. You know, nadi tu behti rehna, parvat ki chitthi le jana tu sagar ki aur nadi tu behti rehna. You know, there is a very well-known poet in Dehradun called Atul Sharma. Now, he has been coming to this NGO, to Himalaya Paryavaran Shikshan Sansthan, since they work on rivers. And he has written a whole book, Molly. I have that book. There are about 80 songs in that. This is only one of them. So he writes about this, that Punji ke chor, na, that they are filling their pockets, because all the people who were involved in the construction of the Tiri Dam were all the mafia. And so they didn't care about Sundarlal Bahuguna, who was protesting with his wife in the Kutia. So these are songs that are created by him. He's a wonderful, so I should not only say songs, actually I should say songs and poems, you know. Several of these are poems. There is a poem, you know, we start with a poem from 1944 of Shridev Suman. Ganga ye teri dhara behti hai sadhiyon mein. This he wrote when he was in jail. And he likens his being in jail to her eternal flow. And he says, I wish I was free like you are. 1944. So the whole book starts with that song. So we've tried to capture many voices, but like yours, there must be 3,000 other songs. You know, 50 is really not this thing, but at least it's a beginning. You know?
It's a beautiful beginning, yeah, and very meaningful songs, very, very. Yeah.
Hmm.
So now we have Nandini Bhattacharya, who has a question.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Actually, it is not really, it is a beautiful and excellent presentation on Ganga. Water is always the site of politics, of the international powers, that we know very well. Actually, I have been working on the other side of the Himalayas, in the Eastern Himalayas, like Darjeeling and Sikkim and Kalimpong, Tista. Tista is their main river. So now, as Professor Kaushal was telling, that we have to revisit our policies. So they wanted to construct 6 dams. Only 4 of them had been constructed. And that made Tista entirely like a pond, not a river. And Tista was known for its fierce flow of streams. And secondly, that part of Himalayas, it is inhabited by the ethnic communities whom we call the tribes. They have a lot of folklores and songs and everything about Tista and Rangit. but that is yet to be recorded, that is yet to be, what I should say, presented before the larger audience. This is a comment, not a question.
We look forward to that, hearing from you about the Tista, huh? Sonali, we should have talks from the Eastern Himalayas also, no? Wonderful, from Sikkim.
This passed just yesterday that there are a few people in our mind from the eastern part of the Himalayas who should talk. I know that Ian Baker will be talking about Arunachal for sure. So, you know, more people, even Nandini ji should contribute to her work on the Tista, because the Himalayas are the Himalayas. They spread, you know, east to west. So,
yeah, Nandini, why don't you talk?
Yes, I will, if I'm invited, because I also made a documentary film on the Lepcha community as well. I mean, there are a lot of rituals. There is a confluence of Tista and Rangit. They called Rangnu and Rangit. Rangnu is the Tista, that is the female river. And there is a beautiful myth associated with it. I don't know whether I have time. I mean, the male river was getting very, very proud of over the female, and then the mother earth became very angry with the male river, and that is the Rangnu, and Tista is the female, and Tista was made the more powerful river than Rangit, and Rangit's flow is rather slow than Tista. This is just one of the myths, and we celebrate every year, all the communities, mostly the Lepchas. I will love to talk one day.
And this is for all of you who are really interested in contributing and speaking on this platform. Please write to me, and we would love to hear you. You know, the more the subjects, more we get enlightened and we spread this knowledge. So this is for all of you. You are scholars and would like to contribute. And the next question is, so I know that Vibhaji doesn't have that icon, so I'm going to ask her to ask the question.
Hi, thank you. Just a second. Yeah, hi, Anjali, that was really wonderful. Hi. I was wondering, I wanted to know, since you mentioned that 125 villages were submerged and people relocated, and how did it affect the kinship relationships, especially distance between the natal village and the village where a person might have got married, and the kind of extended family networks? And are there any songs that depict this? Did you come across that?
Yeah, no, not
songs. And also songs about the villages that were submerged. So,
you know, they don't sing the names of the songs in the song. But, you know, if you look at this, this is just a part of the song. So when you see the book, you will have, like you asked this question on the chat also, the book has, in the running text, you have the English version. But the original version in Devanagari, in Garhwali, is all 50 songs are at the back. Also in script form, in the appendix. And you can also hear them. No? And you can also hear people speaking. So the larger song, you know, does refer to kinship a lot. You know, there are songs of, say, a father writing to a nephew or, extended family saying that this time when you come home, come for a longer time. Because this may be the last time that you come to this home.
Yeah.
And, you know, there are lots of songs that create that kind of imagery. So I found that several songs were sung about the dam and this. Though, you know, for many years now, I have been urging young students to do a research on the impact of displacement on women's lives. You know, it is really an imperative research to be done. Honestly, Vibha. If somebody is interested, I'm urging Lady Irwin students, masters, PhD students, because all these people have been relocated to now physically different homes. They are like little matchboxes in UTD. And when you take somebody from a traditional wood, mud, space, courtyard, habitat, mountain habitat, a home is not just a physical space. It's you wear it on your body as a part of your being. Just like the river is a part of the being, it's not separate from people's lives. So you can't take them away and their animals and put them in matchboxes and say that this is development and this is what we have given you and you adjust to that home. So does physical space lead to acceptance of, you know, cultural spaces that have gone away and taken away from people? Very, very important work needs to be done. Really, I mean, it's such a wonderful idea. I mean, I would be delighted if somebody would like to do a PhD on this, honestly. It's very, but there are songs that talk about kinship relations.
Yeah, I've just for the wider audience, Amita Bhavaskar had done that extended kinship network that got broken during the Narmada displacement.
Yeah.
So that is one that could give an idea as to how to go about it, or other work that has been done, but of course not the songs. I do not know whether she recorded any song, but that's what I was sort of thinking, that all the pathos that is coming out about various
I think Molly is here. We may do the Narmada as the next river, the similar kind of, you know, this methodology is very interesting.
Yes.
Where you are looking at people's perspective of the river.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. Bye. Thanks, Sonali.
I don't want to add something personal here. So my father, he belonged to this place in Mirpur, which is in whatever you may say politically, you know, Pakistan occupied Kashmir or whatever. So it was submerged under the dam waters of the Mangla Dam, the Jhelum River. And all his life, he wanted to go back. So when he was in the foreign services, his first posting was Pakistan. So he went there and he got these pebbles from there on the banks of the river. And he saw the spires of the Shiva temple submerged. And he narrated those stories to me. And then I befriended somebody in academics in Pakistan who sent his PhD student to take photographs of Mirpur submerged under the Mangla Dam waters. And I gifted it to him on his 70th birthday. And he was so teary-eyed when he saw that. And, you know, all these memories of displacement, of home, of that cultural space was so important. So I wrote a project on this. And I haven't found anybody on the Pakistan side to work on this collaborative project on the archaeology of memory. And my father died, you know, I took out the pebbles which were next to his bookshelf, and I wanted to go back to Mirpur and give a part of him, because all his memories were his memories, that he missed Mirpur like anything. So it's so important, displacement, studies on displacement. The archaeology, anthropology of memory, of what it means to be culturally displaced, what it does to your identity, to your belongingness. I really hope people are working on this. And if somebody is on the Pakistan side who wants to work with me on this, I would be so happy.
Thank you. Thank you, Sonali. Thank you, Vibha, for that comment. Really very nice.
So we'll take Dr. Kaushal next. She has a question.
No, it's not a question, but it is just a comment. It's a suggestion. I was just wondering, because this is a Himalayan culture space, and two spaces or two places that are very important is the mountain and the rivers. So I was wondering, Sonali, I mean, after listening to Anjali, listening to Nandini, and as I said, Abhay, it would be a good idea that we can have kind of a series within this, in which people share their research on rivers and Himalayan ecology. I'm sure there are many other people who are here or who are in your list to have worked on the rivers, and make that, you know, like one after another, we have a series of these interactions that would lead to a separate volume altogether on how the contemporary research is looking at the rivers.
River. Very wonderful, wonderful idea. Wonderful idea, Molly. Thank you so much. Wisdom Traditions of the Rivers. ancient rivers, and we can just have a kind of a workshop, and all the papers can be published together. Shonali, that's a good idea.
Yeah, and we talked about it, doing a workshop here, and I think I announced it earlier, and I'm so glad that we all are echoing the same thing of having a thing on rivers, ancient rivers, and all these rivers are just around, so we should have all the people who are working on these come contribute, and let's do a workshop on this. Dr. Kuku Kumar has a question. Dr. Kumar, you have to unmute your mic.
Sorry. Anjali, this question, I just, you know, just while we were, you know, listening to you, I want to know what is the difference, you know, in the perception, because Ganga River is holy to all of us, you know, in the northern region. In terms of perception, what is the difference that you find in feelings and this, that, you know, the other, generally all other people in India, let's say, come down up in the hills, and the people that you have interacted with, what's the kind of, you know, different feelings that, you know, let's say a person from Delhi or from Ukraine, the way we feel about the river and about how they feel about it? Is there any difference?
No, Kuku, that's a really interesting question, because, you know, like, I haven't spoken about that today. There is so many layers and layers and aspects. You know, we have interviewed the tourists when we moved to Rishikesh, you know, because at Rishikesh, it's very urban, so you can't really get to the village people of Rishikesh, though we did move into the Khimsa region and talk to the villages. But in Rishikesh, what we did is we interviewed so many people who had come to the cremation ghat. And I interviewed one Acharya Jagdamba, who talks about life and death and cremation, and recited some. Then talked about Professor Panuli, who was teaching. He talked about geology of the river, the stones of the river, the colors of the water, the flora, the biodiversity. And, you know, the tourists who came there, they were washing their cars, they were washing their clothes at the river. And when we spoke to them, they just said, ki hamare liye toh outing hai, hum toh Ganga itna sundar hai ye. किसी ने बोला था कि गंगा में नहाने से हमारे पाप सारे धुल जाएंगे. सो द टूरिस्ट, द वे दे व्यू द रिवर एंड द लव रेवरेंस दैट, यू नो, द वुमेन हु सैंग गंगा मेरी प्यारी माँ भगवती तू दैनी हुए जाया, आई मीन इट इज इंटायरली डिफरेंट. द टूरिस्ट, यू नो, आई थिंक दिस इज अ वेरी वेरी गुड कमर्शलाइजेशन टूरिज्म, कमिंग टू गंगोत्री इन अ हेलीकॉप्टर, कमिंग टू ऋषिकेश, एंड यू नो इट हैज टोटली चेंज द होल एम्बियंस एंड रिलेशनशिप. सो देर इज, I don't want to say there is that I can't make a generalization that all people who live in urban centers do not have the kind of veneration, worship and celebration and richness that the river adds to their lives. I can't say that. But we interviewed several tourists. So this was a part of the research also. Because, you know, commercialization of religious tourism is a very integral part of this, and migration and globalization, liberalization and its impact on rivers. So I found a tremendous difference between people who come there, you know, for the just having fun at the river. Kehte hain ki hamare paap dhul jayenge. You know, that's a very important point to look at. And how do we promote that kind of religious tourism which inculcates the cultural aspect? You know, that is very important. How do we promote that kind of tourism?
Okay. You know, it's very surprising that of course, we also rever the Ganga, and we have so much of, you know, the feelings, you know, all that is there. And I, you know, like my family, like they are also, you know, they are migrants from Pakistan. And it was very interesting, you know, for me to know from my brothers and from everybody that, you know, like even from Lahore or when the swine Pakistan, they all anyway, when somebody, you know, sort of from the family, they passed away, they used to from there also come to the Ganga. You see, so which means that you know, that feeling of this being holy and your, you know, this is very much all that reverence that is up to our generation. It is there. I don't know about the young generation. They may be going more as tourists. But, you know, that all that combined, I want you to know the feeling that what we or our ancestors might have had, staying far away from the Ganga. There are so many rivers over there, but they also came here only. And obviously, there's some kind of, you know, that feeling that you're talking about. I mean, it's not relevant, perhaps, to your study or talk. But I'm just sharing this, you know, thought and idea. So, just to share it with you, you know. That is all. Hello?
Yeah, Sonali, Vijayalakshmi wants to ask something in connection with this question.
Okay, and after Vijayalakshmi ji, I'll take Vibha ji again, even she had a question to ask, and Molly ji.
Yeah, I had an observation which is very much like Cuckoo's, and that was that in 2013, when we went to Dehradun, there was an amazing, huge amount of people who'd come down from the upper reaches because their homes were destroyed. And there was so much anger among them because they said Ganga has been desecrated. People come there, they drink, they throw garbage, you know, they listen to obscene music. There's pornography. So Ganga Ma is outraged. And this is her way of showing her fury. Ye to hona hi tha. So from the village priest of the Shiva temple there to women who say that, you know, without Ganga Jal, births, marriages, deaths mean nothing to us. And yet our younger generation, hamari bacche, they use the term, they drive these huge off-roads every weekend there. They drink. The pathways are littered with cold drink cans and booze bottles. Is this what tourism means? And they raise the same question Cuckoo raised, that can't both coexist, respect for the river and tourism, which brings us money. I'm not saying it gives the younger people jobs, but can there not be responsible tourism, respect for the ecosystem, as well as respect for the Ganga as a nurturer? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Vijay. That's a very good comment. There are many young people who are working on responsible tourism and ecotourism. I think there is going to be a shift. I think so, really. It is a very, very important question.
And here too in Kulu, we have people like Healing Himalayas who, you know, take out tons of rubbish from the riverfront and other areas. But I think a deeper connect is needed where anthropologists can really work well with the organizations at the grassroots organizations, because it's just not about picking up and throwing it somewhere else, but it's about meaning them that we shouldn't have somebody pick it up and tell us that, you know, there are tons of garbage and we have to clean it up. Every village should be responsible for it as a practice, as a practice on everyday life. So I think the anthropologists have to work with them in very, like, in methodologies, like, you know, what does that do for archaeologists, for example, it's material culture. How do you dispose it? What do you learn from it? And why you should not do it.
Can I share something here for a minute?
Yes.
This Cuckoo Kumar. Yeah. You know, while you are talking about this, it's so upsetting because, you know, I am from the tourism sector, and what you're talking about, this responsible tourism and, you know, ecotourism, you know, there are a lot of webinars and everything going on, and they do realize, and, you know, we have, you know, like associations and people who are aware, and they talk about all this. But But let me tell you, there was a webinar on Uttarakhand and this entire region. And you know, like, while people were talking and they were talking about the properties and what all you could see and the Char Dham and all that. And can you imagine? I mean, I was so upset because, you know, the liquor is not served there. But the first question which every, you know, modern tourist of today, everybody asks this question. Is liquor served in your hotel? Is liquor served? You know, I mean, it was upsetting. You understand what I'm saying. If we are going for a few days, I'm sure we can do without this also. I'm just sharing it with you. I don't want to say anything about tourism because I am from that sector. But I'm just telling you that, you know, this is how the perception and feeling is. Nothing to do with this, but then just to share, you know, to Vijay Lakshmi's response also. So, but better part is that there are a lot of people, you know, who are talking about this, you know, sustainable tourism, responsible tourism. We always talk about it, and it's always connected to, you know, places like what, you know, we are talking about here. I just wanted to share this concept.
You know, Dr. Kumar, it's so important that you raise that point. Years ago, I was in Shillong. This was way back when I was an undergrad. And there, the school children, they kind of, every Friday, different schools have their turn. And the shopkeepers, the markets support the kids. And they clean, you know, with gloves and these kind of stakes. They clean the market. And when people see children doing that, they feel ashamed. And I think that's what I talk about, the grassroots level where school children have to be involved in cleanliness, because then you're bringing up a whole culture of cleanliness. And this whole thing about, you know, during the corona days, we've seen that how when essential services were started, liquor shops were opened. So, so difficult to change the mindset. And there's broken bottles everywhere. And here, I was talking who's at, you know, on whose property I am, we were talking about how the village itself, we have to start from the, I was telling him, oh, we'll do this in the town. He said, no, start with the village, from the basics. Clean up the basic thing. We'll talk to the panchayats, the schools. So wherever we are working, I think we should have this as a part of our own curriculum, not just doing research, but as ma'am was, you know, with the school children who had come to the Sansthan, you showed a picture of that, telling them about the Ganga and its importance and cleanliness and everything. I think we all need to do that in our respective spheres.
Right. You know, Kerala as a model is, I want to say something. We just shifted the topic to tourism. We'll talk about it, Sonali, sometime.
Kuku. You must get involved in this with me. Anybody else?
Dr.
Kaushal. Vibha wanted to say something.
Actually, I was not wearing my specs. I thought Vijay Lakshmi ji is Vibha. And I replied to her. So, Dr. Kaushal, your comment or question.
I just wanted to ask you, Anjali, in these songs or during your conversation, did they bring, I mean, yes, Ganga, whether Ganga or Prakriti, you know, venerated mothers, goddesses, and then, you know, from veneration to the same female deity turned into a commodity, easy to, you know, exploit, easy to commodify. So I was wondering that when women are singing these songs, does this gendered identity of Ganga also translates into a social identity in within the framework of which then women sing about exploitation, about their sorrows or grief. It can be a personal grief, but then it brings in the rivers, you know, or the nature very much into the ambit of sharing that sorrow and grief or going through same grief. And so Ganga or a river as a social gendered being. So do we have any
Molly, this is really so interesting what you're saying. You know, the women, like now, when I, if I see the journey from Gangotri or women living at Harsil and Mukwa, you know, their relationship with the river, because the river is so clean. There are no tourism places like this and nothing polluting the river and all. And so they say ki ye kanya jaisi hai, chanchal. You know, when its gati is a little fast. So they liken the color of the river and they liken the uski nadi ki chaal with the life of a woman. And when she reaches Haridwar, they think, you know, she's quiet and all that, that her daughter-in-law should be like this. I said, ki, Haridwar mein nandi kaisi hai? Bahu jaisi hai. I said, bahu jaisi kaisi? Kyunki bahu ko aise hona chahiye. Shuru-shuru mein wo chanchal hai aur uski gati. But, you know, it's very interesting that when the river comes to Uttarkashi, all these women, and I think the star I haven't mentioned, Geeta Gairola, who's written about 50 songs on the Ganga, her family thinks, you know, that she's mad. Her husband tells the children ki jab tumhari maa ek kavita likhegi na, usko pehle hi phaad ke phenk dena, kyunki wo pagal hai. They don't value her creativity. And I have promised her, Molly, that her 50 songs written on the Ganga, because she is protesting. At Uttarkashi, all the ashrams are throwing their garbage. Things have changed. There is urbanization in Uttarkashi. So the reverence and the nature of the song is changing. This is a very, very interesting point. I think we should bring it out that the worship and the mythology and the veneration was more at Gangotri and Mukwa. And as we came down and the river comes to Uttarkashi, before it is dammed, the entire content and the narrative of the song changes. So this is really very, very important point that you brought up on. So I'm going to remember this.
We need another lecture from you on that. Yeah. I think Abhay is also here, who was coordinating Anjali ji's project. So I was wondering if he would like, and then I also said his own work. So if he would like to add to this discussion, that'll be great. So if Abhay Mishra is somewhere on the side, can he raise his hand? And
he actually raised his hand right after you. So Abhay ji, please speak to the mic, please.
बहुत धन्यवाद, बहुत अच्छा लगा यहाँ आकर आप लोगों को सुन के. अंजलि जी को सुनना हमेशा बहुत अच्छा लगता है, काफी काफी गहराई से बातें करती हैं, काफी भावनाओं के साथ जो है फोक वहाँ का सुनाती हैं, समझाती हैं. मैं दो बातें इसमें जरूर जोड़ना चाहता हूँ. पहला तो जो उन्होंने कहा कि जैसे जैसे नदी बहती है, समाज में महिलाओं की स्थिति उसके हिसाब से ही बदलती है. मैंने पूरी गंगा को देखा है चार बार, दोनों तरफ से, उत्तरी हिस्से से और दक्षिणी हिस्से से. और वहीं से हरिद्वार से आगे जब आप आगे बढ़ते हैं मैदानी इलाके में, तो जहां तक गंगा कानपुर के पहले, जहां पर प्रदूषण बहुत ज्यादा नहीं है, वहां पर जो आपको प्राचीन जो ऋषि स्त्रियां जिनका नाम आप सुनते हैं वो उस क्षेत्र में हुई हैं, यानी रचनाएं जिन्होंने की हैं वो गंगा के उस क्षेत्र में हुई हैं. लेकिन जब आप मैदान में आते हैं, यूपी को थोड़ा आधा यूपी पार करके और बिहार वाला हिस्सा, आप इस क्षेत्र में जहाँ पर पॉल्यूशन है, जहाँ पर जहाँ समाज ने शायद नदी के साथ बहुत बेहतर बर्ताव नहीं किया, वहाँ की महिलाओं की स्थिति एकदम अलग है. थोड़ा सा आगे बढ़िए, झारखंड में जाइए. झारखंड में बहुत छोटा सा हिस्सा है गंगा का, लेकिन इतनी गंगा अपने पूरे पथ पर सबसे ज्यादा गहरी इसी क्षेत्र में है. और यहाँ पर जो आदिवासी कम्युनिटी रहती है, वहाँ की महिलाओं की जो जिजीविषा होती है और एक जो चुपचाप करते रहने वाली जो एक उनका जीवनचर्या है, वो फील कराता है बहुत गहराई वाली. और अगेन जब आप बंगाल पहुंचते हैं तो वो एक तरह से नदी फिर डेल्टा का निर्माण करती है, जैसे अपने शुरुआती दौर में है वो, जहां से वो उसका बनना शुरू हो रहा है. कई धाराएं, कई छोटी छोटी धाराएं मिलकर गंगा का निर्माण कर रही है, वैसे ही बंगाल में पहुंचकर वो धाराओं में बंटने लगती है और हर धारा की अपनी एनर्जी होती है. तो वहाँ की महिलाओं की स्थिति अपेक्षाकृत बहुत बेहतर है. उन्होंने बहुत बार एक तरह से मातृसत्तात्मक समाज का इंडिकेशन दिया है. दूसरी महत्वपूर्ण बात जो मुझे समझ में आ रही थी, इसको सुनते हुए मेरे मन में आया कि इस समय एक फ्रेडरिक विल्सन पर थोड़ा सा मैं रिसर्च कर रहा था. और जब हम नदी की बात करते हैं, नदी के लोक की, फोक की बात करते हैं, तो एक बार उस समाज के बारे में भी सोचना चाहिए. आपको ये जानकर आश्चर्य होगा कि शायद फ्रेडरिक विल्सन इस हिंदुस्तान में शायद पहले ऐसे विदेशी हैं जिनको समाज ने अपने फोक में स्थान दिया है। उत्तराखंड में उपला टकनोर क्षेत्र में जो लोक गान है, जो स्थानीय लोग उसको गाते हैं, उसमें विल्सन का नाम आता है और शायद इस स्तर का सम्मान कभी किसी को नहीं मिला। बहुत सारे लोग शायद टिहरी के राजा का नाम नहीं जानते लेकिन वो विल्सन का नाम जानते हैं। तो उपला टकनोर जो क्षेत्र है जिसके बारे में अंजलि जी बता रही थी, जिस उन्होंने वहां काम किया है, वो पूरे क्षेत्र को जाने बिना गंगा के शुरुआती हिस्से को जानना बड़ा मुश्किल है और उसको जानने के लिए उस समाज को भी जानना चाहिए और उन लोगों को जो वहां पर रहे, जिन्होंने अपना जीवन दिया और कैसे उस समाज को बदला। बस मुझे यही कहना था, बहुत धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू अभिल, थैंक यू।
थैंक यू। एनी अदर क्वेश्चंस? वी डू नॉट हैव एनी हैंड्स रेज्ड, सो at this point, I would thank Dr. Kapila for such an enlightening session where the Ganga has become more alive than ever for us, because now the people, we've seen faces of the people, their songs, we've heard a few, 5 of the 50 songs that we still have to hear. And I hope we are awaiting your book, and I'm sure so many would have that book on their shelves. So thank you so much for this wonderful lecture. And
I think Sonali, Mridula ma'am has raised her hand. Has she? Mridula, say it. No,
I Anjali, fantastic. I've seen you through this whole process. So you've talked a lot about the research that you've done. I was just wondering, at a personal level, if you can share an aha moment. Something that when you really felt very depressed while you were doing your research at a personal level.
At a personal level, the aha moment, Mridula, I'll tell you, I'm sitting in Gangotri and, Ganga Ma's feet are washed. They call the Charan Paduka ceremony. So the priest that day says that Anjali ji mere saath baithengi aur Ganga Ma ke charan dhoengi. And I'm pouring that water, tears are running through my eyes and the whole team is sitting at the back. And when I go to the sanctum sanctorum, the priest takes the red veil that is put on Ganga Ma. He takes it and he puts it around me and says, ki aapka karya aur jis karya ke liye aap apne ghar se nikli hain, wo sampann aur sampuran ho. And you know, when I did the circumambulation and I came out, there were 100 people, all these the team is witness. They started touching my feet and I said, kyun mere paav mat haath lagao, please, main koi nahi hoon, main khali ek insaan hoon. And then the priest came and explained to them that Anjali, you are seeing yourself as a body. They are seeing you at this moment as the embodiment of Ganga Ma because she has blessed you with her veil. Don't be so egoistic. Don't think of yourself as this body. It was such a great moment. It's such a moment, I can't talk about everything. I have so many, in fact, I feel Mridula, the book does not do justice to all the experiences. There are so many, I'm so grateful to you for asking this question, because I would have loved to have shared this moment, but the presentation goes so fast. I want to finish it in 45 minutes and give time.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You should write both your memoirs.
I wanted to share this. Mridula luckily asked me this question. What did you say, Molly?
I said you should, there are so many deep experiences and out of which throws a lot of understanding of people in terms of their own ecologies. I think you should have one, at least even a small book or a volume added to this research as your own personal memoirs.
Yeah. Molly, I think, you're right. Professor Malik has also suggested this, that you do a small, even if it's a 50-page small volume, add it to this as your experiences along the Ganga, on your journey. Because, these kind of experiences, and the sun is setting on the Bhagirathi peaks where the Ganga comes from. And, the picture that Sonali has put on the poster, I'm almost in a trance. I mean, my mother looked at that picture and she says, that are you sure you were on earth or are you in a trance? So these are moments that you can't explain. I think, Molly, that's a lovely idea. You're motivating me. I'm now going to start on this journey of writing my experiences.
And we have another question by VJ. If you could give your introduction so we know who you are.
Hi, I'm Vijay. And my question to Anjali ji is, what next? What after this in her personal Anjali journey with the Ganga?
You know, Vijay, actually, I feel like an abandoned child once the Ganga, you know, once I saw the book in print, I was feeling like totally lost because, you know, it's like I'm not separate from the Ganga. And this whole narrative began with a dream, which I could not share today, that, you know, I saw this nebulous kind of a figure in 2017, January, in my dream saying to me that just like you collected the songs of the women of the Gadwal Himalayas, listen to my song too and write about me. And I didn't know who she was. I didn't know whether it was a goddess, who she was. And I think that deep relationship which I have now with the Ganga, I would love to do another river in the Himalayas. So maybe, you know, if I can do Yamunotri, if I could do the Yamuna right up till Mathura, Vrindavan would be fabulous. Or because this methodology is very interesting. This way of looking at the river through people's eyes, from people's perspective and linking it to ecology, culture, and development and understanding. So maybe another river, Vijay, with your blessings and your good wishes. Thank you, Vijay, for motivating me. What next? Shonali, I'm already on another point.
I have another question. Dr. S.P. Malik has a question for you.
Okay. You haven't seen Professor Malik yet, no?
Yeah, Professor Malik, if you could ask your question.
He is, I don't know if he knows how to do this.
He has to unmute.
Okay, now can you hear me?
Yeah, yes. We can. Yeah.
I say in this whole talk, you've not the emphasis on the sacred. The sacred relationship of Ganga is sacred to the people. The sacredness is very important. Otherwise, there's no relationship to Ganga in any other form. It's part of their whole system. And I think that should be emphasized a lot because without the sacredness, you cannot know. Urban people cannot relate to the Ganga.
Yeah, and they
part
cannot...
Part of their life through the sacredness. And the sacredness is very important. And you implied it, but it should be emphasized that without that sacred relationship and that kind of understanding, unsaid. Intangible understanding is a very crucial thing to know. That's all I wanted to emphasize.
So Professor Malik has given a very important insight that it is the sacredness and the relationship, the sacred relationship that the people have to the river, and they actually experience that sacredness of the cultural landscape. It is not divorced from them. Like there is not a dichotomy between the sacred and the secular like that. So even the myths are not sort of separating them. They see this oneness. I think we have to reiterate that. And the content of the songs and what I've said, the voices of the women actually do reiterate the sacred. But you're saying it needs to be said more strongly. Thank you so much.
Because it comes from the heart, you see. It comes from the heart. The rest is from the head. The head won't understand this. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So we do not have any more raised hands, and I will upload.
I can see Rudra over there. Rudra.
Is there Rudra? Say hello.
Hello.
She needs a haircut.
I don't need a haircut.
Okay. So I do want to say that, you know, 2 years ago when I shared it with Anjali ma'am, when my father died, I did all the last rites, and that was my first face off with the Ganga.
when I did all the ceremonies and you know, tried to let go of everything material that reminded me of my father. And I think the most the moment where I really connected with the Ganga and my father's memory was when I took those 5 dips in the Ganga after finishing all the things that were going through the Panda and everything. And those 5 dips were like, they brought me face to face with what the Ganga is all about. And today, when you talked about the song, about the people, what it means, and what Professor Malik just talked about, the sacredness of the river, I think for India as a whole, for each one of us who lives in India, the Ganga is something so important, omnipresent. And for you to bring that out in this book, I'm so grateful. I think I'm grateful from all of us who are here and who are not here. And also, Dr. Kapila, today we had about 102 people in attendance.
Oh my God. So slowly
and steadily, we are increasing our tribe. And thank you all who are contributing with your work here. And you have given me more names. And all of you, whoever wants to participate, please do. And my apologies, you know, I'm trying to moderate the group as well. And I'm sorry if I come out as very, very, dictatorial in my post, that don't post this. But I really don't want this group to get scattered from the Himalayan part of it. So thank you all for being here. We will be announcing our next lecture for next Sunday for our Unlocked 0.1, 0.2, whatever that series is. So keep in touch, and so many ideas, so many suggestions from all of you, and we want to take this to the next level. Thank you, ma'am, for your first lecture on your book. We are so lucky.
Thank you, Shanali. Is it possible to put this on YouTube? A lot of people could not listen to it.
Yes. I have already posted 3 of the talks on YouTube. I was successful in doing it yesterday. My internet is fine now. So I will be processing it. Today it will be online tomorrow. And now I don't
Shanali
have
to worry. Some snapshots of the comments, if you can send me, because
I'll send you the chat text. I'll do that right now, in fact.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Molly. Thank you, Mridula. Thank you, Professor Malik. Thank you, all the participants who are here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, Vijay. Thank you so much for just being so far and taking this whole
thing.
She's so amazing.
Thank you, Dr. Anjali. Thank you, Dr. Gupta and all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.